I lost my livelihood in farming. I couldn't farm. They took away the one thing that I really loved, and that was farming. That's what the USDA did.
He showed me a big tarp that had the words on it, "Nigger, go home."
The lack of commitment by too many people to not really caring whether we did justice or not.
Even as long as it's been, you know, we've experienced discrimination for a very, very long time, and most people would have given up. To this date, I haven't given up, and I never will give up, you know, until justice is served.
That's what my daddy would always say. He says, I wasn't in trouble or anything. Everything was fine until I went up to defend my dad. And he says, what was I supposed to do? He says, I'm a man, and that's my daddy. I'm supposed to defend him.
He said, don't let USDA take my land. It was like anybody else, but just don't you let them have it. And we've done that. Nobody else has taken it either, but for sure the USDA will never get it.
Quite frankly, I say that the United States Department of Agriculture murdered
them.
My mother and father and my brother. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Gary Johnson, and all the work that you have done for and with promoting civil rights and promoting the justice for Black farmers. Tonight, we are going to, in preparation for the Whistleblower Summit in Washington, and we have a panel called Continued Systemic Discrimination at the U.S. Department of Agriculture, and it's presented by the Coalition of Minority Employees at the U.S. Department of Agriculture and the Justice for Black Farmer Group, put together and made up of Eddie Slaughter is been working with us, Michael Stovall, farmer from Alabama, and we also have Wayman Henson from Texas. And our good friend Eddie Slaughter is from Georgia. He has been in this struggle for years. And both he and Stovall I've been knowing for many, many years. And Dr. Henson has been working with us, and you'll see some of his work in the trailer. It so happened tonight we have Marcel Reed with us from the Whistleblower Summit. She's gonna give us a overview of what and why this summit is so important and why the coalition and the issue of continued discrimination at USDA, especially having the farmers on tonight, she will articulate the importance of it and the importance of us sharing this effort with the Whistleblower Summit, which is started this week in Washington, D.C. on Capitol Hill. Marcel Reed, thank you so very much for taking time out of your busy schedule and give us a brief rundown or overview as to why this is so important to so many people, the Whistleblower Summit in Washington today. Thank you for being on.
Thank you, Lawrence. First of all, I'd like to thank everyone who's joined us on this panel, and thank you, Lawrence, for inviting me. I know Dr. Wayman Henson as a longtime supporter of this effort with the Black farmers, breaking out not only the impact on it when it comes to land, but also the impact psychologically that very many people don't calculate in. They talk about land and money, but they don't understand just how deep the trauma can be when people are separated from land. I would like to thank Stovall, because Michael Stovall has been working in this field far before I knew about it. I found out about this through Lawrence Lucas and the USDA Coalition. And for years and years, I've heard Stovall talk about the hardship that he's been under as a Alabama Black farmer. My family hails from Alabama, though I was raised in the far West. And I have heard stories all my life about farmers who have lost their land. I'm sure that it impacted my family, but sometimes the memory is so long ago and the pain is so deep until people don't talk about it anymore. Lawrence Lucas has been leading this coalition since I first met him. And I'd like to talk about how important it is that these men have been gathering on Capitol Hill. Often our stories are told as whispers or only to each other. This is an opportunity for people to see what is happening not only with Black farmers, but with Black people and whistleblowers across the diaspora, to be honest with you. Whistleblowing is not something that we generally consider ourselves. When we talk about our struggles, they put us into civil rights and they write it off as a civil rights struggle. It's a civil rights struggle, and therefore, as important as it is, it's an attempt to diminish its importance. One of the things that the summit does is we try to raise Title VII complaints, civil rights complaints, to the same status and importance as any other whistleblower complaint. You know, you hear about other whistleblowers, the Snowdens of the world or whoever, and they become either infamous and very famous, or they become very well paid. Generally, neither one happens to us. We simply report the fault and it's swept under a rug somewhere, so no matter what it is. So whether it's Black farmers who have supported us from the beginning and who we wholeheartedly supported the summit, whether it is police officers as led by Matthew Fogg and the Marshal Service, whether it is EEOC within the government writ large, which is run by Tanya Ward Jordan, or whether it is medical whistleblower, which we are now focusing on this year. And those that are focusing on it this year are focusing on kidney dialysis, which affects most Black families in one way or another. The summit is the place that we as Black people can go to every year. It excludes no one, but it also doesn't diminish our issues, diminish our voice. We give out a very prestigious award. As a matter of fact, the most prestigious award that whistleblowers can give, which is called the Pillar. And we give that award out every year to note whistleblowers that may not be famous, but who have struggled. We notice their, we applaud them for their efforts, for their ability to hang in like Stovall has for all of these years. And we open our arms to everyone to come to Capitol Hill, because when you sit in someone's living room, they cannot say you were not at their home. And that is the real purpose of the summit. We bring the issues on Capitol Hill. We speak to them in their place, and they cannot then go home and say, they didn't know, they never heard of it, we never brought it to anyone's attention. We bring every issue to their attention every year, and we defy them to say they haven't heard of it, they don't know about it, and to ignore us out of hand.
Hey, thank you very much, Mrs. Marcel Reed, for being with us tonight and giving that clarity as we move forward into the subject matter that we will be talking about tonight. And that is the continual racism at the U.S. Department of Agriculture. Thank you, Eddie Slaughter. Thank you, Dr. Henson. Thank you, Michael Stovall from Alabama. I want to make sure that I do cover Slaughter, and I know you from Georgia, and I know you don't want me to leave out the fact is that's where you're from. We're going to talk now about the systemic discrimination going on, and I'd like for you all to give a quick overview and only two or three more minutes because we want to have time for dialogue and fit this in a very small piece. But Eddie Slaughter, you've been around this issue. Give us about two or three minutes as to why this continued and why you're here tonight to talk about the continued racism at the U.S. Department of Agriculture from a program standpoint or from a Black farmer standpoint from Georgia.
I think that when you look at it, continued racism, you have to realize that this is ain't just not started. When we look at Secretary of Agriculture, Tom Vilsack, he was there when Joe Biden was vice president of Barack Obama, and Barack Obama signed a $2.5 billion settlement for Black farmers. And after they paid the lawyers about $90 million, there was over $1 billion that was left that just simply disappeared under the Biden, Jim Crow Joe, and Tom Vilsack. And nobody there asked where this over $1 billion went, because it was slated for Black farmers. So when he came back and wanted to put him in as USDA Secretary of Agriculture, he knew how he had treated us before. He was a part of when they turned up the heat for economic terrorism. And that was every Black farmer in America that owned USDA was offsetted with all kinds of ways. It was just like terrorism when they do to the Taliban and to Al-Qaeda and all of them. Everywhere that a dollar came to Black farmers by way of the United States government, whether it was the income tax return, they offset it and took that from you. You didn't get that. Your subsidy payments, you know, your land-based payments. And they really, it was more of a fact that we are going through and have to suffer economic terrorism at the hands of Jim Crow Joe and the Grand Wizard himself, Tom Vilsack. And this is ongoing. This is not, we're not talking about, as they talk about when they talk about reparations, something that happened years ago to people that may have, you know, that are no longer alive, or those that even suffered is no longer alive. But we are talking about justice for what we suffered in this present day, in this present time, and as the discrimination and the injustice continue, and there's no end in sight to what's wrong. And every time a Black farmer dies, they go there and cut out 4 or 5 acres for the family, then let them buy the house, and they take all and run away with all the land. So, you know, we really got a bad situation going on. And Jim Crow Joe and the Grand Wizard himself, Tom Vilsack, they are actually practicing racism even as we speak.
Thank you very much, Eddie. I now would like to go to Dr. Henson. I'm going to leave Michael Stovall from Alabama last. Dr. Henson, can you share with us just briefly for about 3-4 minutes, what do you think the continual problem with the continued discrimination under past administrations and this administration? Dr. Henson from Texas.
Let me say a couple of things, Lawrence. Thanks for that question. Number one is, I think we have to assume that America was built upon the backs of Black Africans, underlying the principle of white supremacy. And you take that mindset and you fold it over into the plantation days, you could say that there's a planter class mindset that took place in the days of the plantations. So if you were a plantation owner and you had 10 to 15 to 20 enslaved people working for you, you were a millionaire or a billionaire. And so that mindset that went on then, I think is going on within the USDA. And so what I typically say is that the USDA does what the USDA does. The USDA assumes what the USDA has always assumed. And the assumption is that the advantage always goes to the white farmer or the white planter, so to speak. And so if the planter class mindset is embedded within the USDA, then that's going to be the thing that organizes its policies, its programs, how it handles loans. It goes all the way from the secretary's chair all the way down to the county committee. And so you can see how that mindset and the way that mindset plays its way out in terms of who gets the loans, farm operating loans, who gets the loans for land, who gets told that land is available and who doesn't get told, who walks in wanting to fill out a loan and hear the words, we've got plenty of money, but we don't have people for like you. So there's something about that mindset that runs through the history of the USDA, and it is deeply embedded. And it is so deeply embedded that people can't even see it. So if racism and white supremacy is the water that you breathe, the air that you breathe, you're not going to be able to step back and say, why am I doing what I'm doing? Either it's too invisible to see, or you don't want to see it, or you're committed to maintaining the USDA as it has always been maintained. It has always been there from the get-go and is there now. And it's going to take some hearts and some minds and some willpower to get it out.
Thank you very much for that clarity. Michael Stovall, here, I'd like for you to talk about the systemic discrimination, how it's continuing, and kind of bring us up to date. I think it's important that, Stovall, they've touched on some pieces of the problem, but we know that the continued discrimination, it does exist. But can you tell us what is going on now? And can you tell me to add in addition to that, talk about why USDA is called the last plantation, please. Michael Stovall from Alabama.
Well, Michael Stovall here from Town Creek, Alabama. The USDA is called the last plantation because it has so much systemic racism in the agency as a whole. Black farmers has been mistreated, taking their land from way back when, and they're steady doing it. And employees the same, if you try to do the right thing, still gonna be ostracized and discriminated against. And the agency is embedded racism in that agency, and nobody chooses to do anything about what's going on in the U.S. Department of Agriculture. So when you go in the local county office, apply for a farm ownership or operating loan, you're even getting less amount of money you applied for, so you cannot cash flow with your loan, or they don't have any money at all. So it's from one situation to the next situation. That's what they do to Black farmers across the United States of America. That's why they call it the last plantation. Now, the county agency makes a determination where your loan is approved or not approved, and how much money you should get and how much money you should not get. So those are the problems that the agency uphold the wrongdoing of the county committee, the Farm Service Loan Officer, and the head of the USDA in the state office uphold the wrongdoing of this agency. This agency is embedded racism all across the board, from one county to the next, from one state to the next. And so it's just systemic racism. Now we bring in Dr. Cornel West, to ask for a state of emergency for Black farmers across the United States of America, because we done lost over 16 million acres of land, and we steady losing land. Just like they passed this $5 billion, and here it is, most Black farmers never got debt relief. And here it is now, you got 38 cages to even qualify for the discrimination with no economies. How can you determine from zero to 500,000 if you don't have any economies? And why did you put a cap on it when you got farmers as old $20 and $30 million because of discrimination in the land that they have lost? This agency is corrupted from the bottom up, and we got a lot of people that look like me and you is on the tip of the USDA to take us out. They're getting paid under the table to not do the right thing when it comes to Black farmers and getting due process. So as many Black farmers I have saw that had passed away because of the fight of the struggle, they sick. The ones that still left, when got old, when they lost a lot of land, lost income, old tractors ain't worth even putting in the shop. They didn't run us completely out of business. When these white farmers ride around and millions of dollars of equipment get subsidied out of the yang yang, and Black farmers can't even have a decent tractor on the farm to continue to farm. This is unbelievable what this country had done to Black American farmers across the United States, and it needs to be done something about. Thank you.
I am so very blessed to have with me four exemplary brothers who have been fundamentally concerned about one of the most crucial issues, often overlooked and underplayed in the history of this country, which has been the plight of Black farmers. We have a variety of different voices, a variety of different perspectives that zero in on the scope and depth of the injustice, what has been attempted, and various efforts, often too inadequate, but still bouncing back, trying to ensure that truth and justice reign and truth and justice prevail. We know, in fact, the history of the very, very ugly white supremacist subjugation, marginalization, discrimination against the heroic Black farmers. And I want to say on a personal note that my great-grandfather was one of the great Black farmers in Louisiana who had struggles over his land year in and year out. So this is a very personal issue. But of course, for all of us, no matter what color, gender, sexual orientation, no matter what section of the nation, this is a moral issue. For me as a Christian, it's a spiritual issue. And as citizens, it is a civic issue. And so I hope that you all are able to spend some good time as you open your hearts, minds, and souls to the marvelous voices of these four brothers who have played crucial roles, historic roles, in trying to hold up the bloodstained banner of the struggle for justice of Black farmers in the United States and especially in the South.
Very much. I want to go to, and I'll go back to Eddie Slaughter. Eddie, you've been around and you've seen political people come and go at USDA, president after president, secretary after secretary, and administration after administration. What do you think is one of the problems that we have? And if USDA is claiming that they're doing so much good, and claiming that they are doing a better job than any administration in history, is that true? Is this administration, are they holding people accountable? Are they transparent? And are they delivering justice? And the one thing that I'd like to know is the organizations that are supposed to be looking out for our benefit, what do you think? What is your position? You got a couple of minutes. Just talk about what you think about our leadership from the Congress to Black leadership to others, advocacy. What have they done, or how have they failed, or how have we failed?
We as a people, we are worse off now than we was 50 years ago in this country. They have really killed off all of our leaders and all the ones that they couldn't buy off. And so the rest of them are pretty much buying off. When you look at the fact that Black farmers across the country, about 17 different states, showed up in Washington, D.C. earlier this year. And the Congressional Black Caucus conveniently found it that, hey, we need to leave town for this day that y'all are gonna be here. So they are always missing in action. And the thing that I think that we need to confront, especially the Congressional Black Caucus with, and I would pose it as it was, Haman, when Mordecai opposed it to Queen Esther, how do you not know that God has not called y'all to the Congress for such a time as this? All the injustice that's going on, all of the suffering that's going on, you know, and how can you be in there like Dr. Dwayne Goldman? You see the suffering that your brothers and sisters are going through, and you will look their way, and it was much better that you would make a dollar off of their suffering, be mad at it, but yet and still would not do the right thing. Dr. Goldman, no, he done already said that they're not planning on even paying us the $500,000, you know? And then they brought the fact up that the money that they took from us illegally by offsets, all of those millions of dollars, they have decided they're not going to return this to us. So where is the Martin Luther King that we're going to turn to for leadership? Where's the Malcolm X or the Mega Evers? All of this, you can't look in the mirror to ourselves to become the leadership, then we don't have any, because the Dixocrats in the Democratic Party has done an amazing job of being able to buy off all of the elected leadership. So they would mother rather look the other way than to mess with their comfort zone. So when they look at me suffering, Michael Stovall suffering, others suffering, you know, they don't have a heart for it. Because what you're looking at, when you look at USDA, you got the Office of General Counsel. And they run USDA. So regardless of how you buy, get into a assistant secretary for civil rights, you're not going to allow any cases to go before the administrative law judges. None of these cases are to be heard, even though the Constitution of the United States says that we're entitled to due process. Even though the consent decree wrote it, that we would at least have a hearing. You know, but that has not happened. And equal justice under the law cannot exist in America when you got us not being able, and we went through Pigfoot, and there was no appeal process there. It's amazing how you want to see why the Office of General Counsel did. We found discrimination in emergency loans. We found discrimination in equipment loans. Discrimination in livestock loan, discrimination in production loan. But amazing, we could not find one evidence of discrimination in farm ownership loan, because that deals with the land. Okay. That deal would return to you the land. Okay. So you can see how bad the situation is when they did it. The officer, you know, you go through and all of those lawyers with Pigfoot. How is it that you can find all that discrimination in all those cases, but you can't find one with farm ownership loan discrimination? Not one. And even though the Pigfoot consent decree said that when you your case is ruled and they find you, the few that they did find it in it, and they say, yeah, okay, we're gonna give you $50,000. And they were supposed to discharge all of the debt. But because we're dealing with land, and this whole fight is about the land, is the reason why we can't receive the justice to okay, return thank to you. Us.
Oh. Yeah, thank you very much, Eddie. We're going to kind of keep moving on. Thank you for that very good input. Wait a minute. I want you to, it's being said by this administration that they're doing a great job with making sure that. And you only have about 2 or 3 minutes. Tell us, what is the status of the processing and the processing of applications supposedly by these hubs, and that the U.S. Department of Agriculture control the hub and the process. You have about 3 minutes.
Let me say just kind of a brief intro to that. I think we're in trouble in this land because our congressionals don't have the heart to make some changes. Under Senator Warren, we had the Justice for Black Farmers Act, and Booker signed on, Warnock signed on. And then from there, we move into the American Rescue Plan Act. And so it goes from Black farmers to socially disadvantaged farmers and ranchers. And then white farmers jumped out, filed 12 lawsuits to derail that process. And that's a long story. And then comes along in 2022 with the Inflation Reduction Act. And now the recipients of debt relief are distressed borrowers. And then there's a large sum of money as well for discrimination, $2.1 billion over in that pot. And so any farmer of any color, any gender can come along and say, I've been discriminated against, and you have potential access to that. So that's the prelude to what you're asking. So what's happened with Secretary Vilsack is that he has set up an administrator at the top who answers to him, two hubs who have two regions each, and then a number of 6 or 8, 12, something like that, cooperators. And so there are cooperator groups across the country who will be on the receiving end of applications and materials and that sort of thing. And they'll funnel this thing upstream so that eventually it gets to the administrator and then it gets over to Tom Vilsack. And so that process says that there's a max of $500,000 for any case. And the cooperators that I've listened in on say, don't even think about getting that much money. And then when you add the white farmers in, that's really diluting what could happen with Black farmers. And that's another long story. And then, as Eddie mentioned under Pickford, under this process of under Vilsack, there is no appeals process. And so you get what you get, and you can't appeal it. So the deck is stacked so that the application process is 40 pages plus all of these materials that you must have or that you may have, and they all have to be submitted either hard copy to a local agency or via PDF file into the hub. And then once you get up there, then it's out of your hands. So,
well, wait a minute, hold on, because we only have a short period of time. Tell us real quickly in the next 30 seconds or so, because I want Stovall to close out. Tell us, is this process a fair process, and should this process be challenged by those leaders in Congress and otherwise?
The short answer is no, this is not a fair process. Long story short, absolutely not. I think it's designed for failure. I think it's designed to wear out the heart and the soul and the body and the mind of Black farmers. And so, yes, it should be appealed. The process should be appealed by the congressionals on Capitol Hill.
Okay. Thank you very much. Stovall, we're going to let you do the closing out here. Tell us from your perspective, with all this shenanigans going on in Washington and our leaders not speaking up and people taking money at the pain and suffering of Black farmers. And tell us, where does Cornel West fit in this equation? And you will get the last word.
Dr. Cornel West fit in this equation to help bring justice for the Black farmers, to intervene and try to help bring these farmers where they can get due process that they had never got before. You know, it's a state of emergency. That's what it's going to take to bring these farmers to get due process, because a lot of these farmers got millions of dollars of damages. $500,000 is a drop in the bucket. like I said, if it don't start out right, it won't end up right. They didn't start out right because somebody got in the room, made a deal for black farmers, and black farmers wasn't there. That's been the problem that black farmers have been having all these years. Can't nobody speak for a black farmer no better than a black farmer. When you got black farmers that lost thousands of acres of land and you want to give them $500,000 and it's a guess if you don't get it or not, that's a problem with that. This agency is corrupted. These white farmers, they paid them over 20-something billion dollars. They got it in 2 days. Black farmers can't get due process. It's a state of emergency. They can fix the spotted owl, the beaver, and everybody else, but they won't pay these black farmers with due process. It's a problem with this country. It's racist. This agency needs to be put in receivership, and justice needs to be brought to these black farmers. Not yesterday, but right now, right now, right now. It needs to happen right now. It's terrible what they continue to do to us. And everybody want to turn a deaf ear to the racism at this Department of Agriculture. And the Justice Department is all part of it. And they need to be held accountable as well. We call for the Black Caucus to do something about what's going on at this agency. It's terrible. They're killing black farmers. They dying by every day. We losing some black farmer because he done went through so much pain and suffering to try to hold on to the land. I have a finding of discrimination, a breach of settlement agreement. I have watched these farmers die, suffer, cry, trying to hold on to the land. It's terrible what they have done to us. And we need to call the state of emergency to fix this problem from the bottom to the top, from the top to the bottom, and clean up the USDA and pay these black farmers what you do.
Thank you very much. We are running out of time. We're right at the 45-minute period. Look, I want to thank Gary Johnson for putting this panel on and getting us Zoomed and organized. I want to thank Eddie Slaughter from Georgia. I want to thank Dr. Henson from Texas. And again, Stowell, I can't thank you enough because you understand not only the political ramifications in the broad base, but also the systemic problem as it relates to USDA and its racism. Thank you very much, gentlemen. We're going to have to close at this point, but we hope to join and come back on at another time. I thank you all very much, and good night.
Indeed, indeed. Can I just jump in just a little bit because all four of you all have been so powerful, but it just hits me so hard when you look at the different ways in which white supremacy in its vicious way and manners works and gets refashioned one generation after the other. I think about the Homestead Act of 1862. They got free land for some of the precious vanilla brothers and sisters. You know what I mean? I ain't got nothing against it. I took 163 acres homesteader, but then lo and behold, here in the South for black folk, the 40 acres and a mule never came forward, never enacted, already a promise that was reneged on. And then as we emerge, we got black farmers who have land like James West, my great-great-grandfather. But then they come up with all kind of maneuvers and shenanigans to try to shrink his land less and less. And I know there's a larger story about agribusiness and the corporatization of agriculture and so forth, but that doesn't mean the white supremacy is not going on. And where do you go? You go to the US government. You think that the Department of Agriculture is going to actually be a source, a resort of fair treatment. And I'm glad you mentioned Brother Espy. He's out of Arkansas, right? Was he out of Arkansas?
Mississippi.
Mississippi. That's right. He's out of Mississippi. Even better, as much as I love Arkansas, I'll bring Mississippi, the Delta, with the blues. You know, we talking about Sunhouse. We talking about Robert Johnson in there. See, but you, somebody like Espy, I'm glad you all lifted him because it looks like he tried to be a counterforce against the dominant white supremacist forces. And he held on for a bit, but then lo and behold, new waves come through, fast-talking folk come through, people posing and posturing, acting as if they are in genuine solidarity with Black farmers on the ground, but they get co-opted, they too often sell out, and you end up with folk getting treated even worse.
You know, America's not unique in its sins as a country. We're not unique in our evils, to be honest with you. I think where we may be singular is a refusal to acknowledge them and the legends and myths we tell about our inherent, you know, goodness to hide and cover and conceal so that we can maintain a kind of willful ignorance that protects our innocence. See, the thing is that when the Tea Party was happening, We were saying, pundits, oh, it's just about economic populism. It's not about race. When people knew, social scientists were already writing that what was driving the Tea Party were anxieties about economic demographic anxiety. Shifts, that the country was changing, that they were seeing these racially ambiguous babies on Cheerios commercials, that the country wasn't quite feeling like it was a white nation anymore. And people were screaming from the top of their lungs, yo, this is not just simply economic populism. This is the ugly underbelly of the country. See, the thing is this, and I'll say this, and I'll take the hit on it. There are communities that have had to bear the brunt of America confronting, white Americans confronting the danger of their innocence. And it happens every generation. So somehow we have to kind of, oh my God, is this who we are? And just again, here's another generation of babies. Think about it, that two-year-old had his bones broken by two parents trying to shield him from being killed. A woman who has been married to this man for as long as I've been on the planet almost, lost her husband. For what? And so, what we know is that the country has been playing politics for a long time on this hatred. We know this. So it's easy for us to place it all on Donald Trump's shoulders. It's easy for us to place Pittsburgh on his shoulders. It's easy for me to place Charlottesville on his shoulders. It's easy for us to place El Paso on his shoulders. This is us. And if we're gonna get past this, we can't blame it on him. He's a manifestation of the ugliness that's in us. I've had the privilege of growing up in a tradition that didn't believe in the myths and the legends because we had to bear the brunt of them. Either we're going to change, Nicole, or we're going to do this again and again, and babies are going to have to grow up without mothers and fathers, uncles and aunts, friends, while we're trying to convince white folk to finally leave behind a history that will maybe, or embrace a history that might set them free from being white. Finally.
What else?
Lord help us.
Just like the river I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming. coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. I go to the movie and I go downtown. Somebody keep telling me don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he wants